Vouching and verification. It's a small chapter, easy chapter. There is nothing great in this chapter. You have to just remember a few points. It is not difficult like a company audits chapter or auditing standards. In fact, even auditing standards are difficult, but this is absolutely simple chapter. And I have written it everything in front of you. Some points I'll be dictating that you have to remember. How questions come on this topic? First, I'll tell you, give you an idea about the questions. How questions can be asked? Generally, in every audit paper, there is a compulsory question on vouching and verification. And I suggest to people that you first advise your first advice to attend this question only. This is generally question number 4 of your paper. Okay? Question number 4. The question will be something like this: how would you, as an auditor, verify or vouch the following? So some 4 transactions will be given to you. Let's take an example. They would give you, say, plant and machinery. How will you verify plant and machinery? Then they will give you 1 transaction, say, inventory. How will you verify inventory? There is no fixed pattern. Any permutation combination comes. Then they will give you gratuity. They'll give you 1 more transaction, gratuity paid to employees. How will you verify that? Then they will give you transaction sale of scrap. How will you verify that? Some people say scrap is nothing but it's a junk material, scrap material. And each question will be for 4 marks. So 4 fours are 16 marks, 15 to 16 marks question. Okay, this is how it will be printed in the paper. Now all you need to do, you have to see whether the transaction which they give you is an asset, whether it's a liability, whether it's an income, whether it's an expense. Okay, so for asset, liability, income and expense, I will be giving you certain points which you have to remember. You just have to go, as I say, vomit the points in exam. Okay, just you have to write the same things. No need to study any textbook, even I would suggest you this textbook also you should not study for vouching and verification. This is like you just study what I'm giving you in writing. That much is sufficient. Study that only for this chapter and write that thing in the exam. Okay, if you write the points which I dictate properly, if you write it, you can score at least 12 to 13 marks out of 16. See, theory, you don't get full marks. Okay, theory. So suppose if you get 12, 1 mark will be deducted. Suppose, the examiner wants something else also. So he may deduct 1 mark, or maybe your spellings are wrong, or maybe grammatical mistake, handwriting not good. For such reasons, theory, you don't get full marks. But you can get close to full marks also. So you have to just write to the points which I'll be telling you in the classroom. Those people who have written, when you get the audit paper, the very first question that you should attempt is vouching and verification, which is very easy to answer. However, this chapter has so many things. Like, they can ask you any asset. I have just written few examples, but they can ask you any asset. So the points which you will verify for an asset will be same only, whether you verify plant and machinery, whether you verify investments, whether you verify inventory, any asset. Likewise, liability, any liability, the points will be the same. So this is like the background I gave you, how this question comes in exam. This is how it will be asked. First and foremost thing, I always believe that first we should know what is the concept, then we will go into writing those points. So the concept is as follows. When I tell you that a transaction takes place in a company, suppose if we take an example of a transaction taking place in a company. Suppose goods are purchased. Okay, that day I was explaining you purchase transaction. Let us take, suppose goods are purchased. Now we all know that when we purchase the goods, purchased. So tell me, don't you think that there will be something like a bill or an invoice along with it? Yeah, so now an invoice or a bill will be there along with it. Now this invoice or bill, whatever it is, it will be entered into the accounting system. The purchase manager will record only the quantity received. Purchase manager is not concerned with the amount. So suppose if the goods are purchased, you will also have a goods received note with you, a GRN, goods received note. So this GRN will have the quantity. Okay. Or if suppose GRN is not having the quantity, there is one more document called as Chalan. The Chalan will have the quantity. This document, the GRN or the Chalan, or sometimes even the purchase order copy, the PO copy, all these are copies or documents meant for the purchase manager. This purchase manager, on the basis of these documents, will record the entry in the management information system, as I told you that day also. Likewise, when the bill will have two things. The bill will have quantity also, and the bill will have the amount also, the value also. So quantity multiplied by some rate will be given there, and amount will be there. So this amount will be entered in the tally software. Okay, that means it's the accounting system. Tally is a very worldwide popular software. It's not only used in India, everywhere it is used. It's a very good software to use for accounting. So what happened here, two people did the recording. One person did a recording of the amount, one person did recording of the quantity. That means what? When a transaction takes place in the system, and whenever it is entered in the accounting system, what is the proof that a transaction is entered into accounting system? What is the proof? The proof has to be there, and that proof is nothing but it's a voucher. The proof is the voucher. So what is voucher? Voucher is an evidence, or it's a documentary evidence, I can say. It's a documentary. Always you will find vouchers in the form of documents. They're nothing like electronic vouchers. This always, maybe you may be very much technologically upgraded, but vouchers will be always in the form of documents only. Voucher will be a documentary evidence that the accountant has recorded the transaction in the accounting system. So whenever transactions are recorded in the accounting system, a document like this is prepared. Suppose this is a document. Okay, it's a document. What will be the contents of this document? This document will have the name of the company written. Suppose this is voucher of X Limited. It will have a place where you can write the date. It will have a place where you can write the heading. So through which head the transaction has been entered. Suppose if I say goods purchase, I will say purchase account is debited. Okay, head is purchases. Then I will write here, I'll have a space here for the person to sign on this voucher. Now this signature say can be of the cashier who's going to make payment to the supplier. That means the cashier has also seen this voucher. Now one more signature will be there, that will be for the accountant to sign. Why accountant to sign, sir? Because he is entering the transaction in the system. He enters in the system. Then there will be one more place, sir. If the goods are purchased which are a very heavy amount, suppose the goods which are purchased worth 10 lakh rupees. Okay, so here it should be also certified by the CFO of the company. Heavy transaction. See, the objective of doing vouching is to make sure that every voucher should be properly sanctioned. Okay, every voucher should be properly signed. Sanctioning is what we are looking for here. Because in companies, there are so many purchase sale transactions, there are so many expenses and incomes taking place. How will you keep a record of all these things? Who is authorizing them? Who is signing them? So, sir, we can find out everything from the accounting system. Then why there is a need to sign on the voucher? This will act as an evidence for the auditor. When the auditor comes and he starts checking, he will be given, for every transaction which is entered in the system, he will be given a voucher. So he will notify the amount. Okay, it is 10 lakh rupees, he'll put a tick. And in auditing, we put ticks like this. Okay, and then he will see the transaction in the trial balance also. In the trial balance also, it is showing 10 lakh rupees, he'll put a tick in the trial balance. It's a physical copy of trial balance. Then the next transaction he will see, okay, he'll put a tick here, he'll put a tick. Likewise, the third voucher he sees, he put a tick. So this is how you do. In the first year of your articleship, you will be told to do auditing like this. I told you that I'm not training you for only IPCC exam. I'm training you how you'll do your audits also. The very first year you join any big company, small company, medium sized company, they are definitely going to give you bulky vouchers to check. Okay, your whole day will go in checking vouchers only. And like in a company, you will be told to check at least 500 vouchers, 600 vouchers in a day. It's a very difficult task because you have to see so many things here. You have to see whether the vouchers are properly dated or not. They are properly signed or not. Sometimes the vouchers also have the seal of the company. So they are sealed or not. Whether the amount is written in words also, whether the amount is written in numbers also, everything you have to verify. If suppose a voucher is of heavy transaction like 10 lakh rupees, whether the senior, this is a senior signature, senior person signing, this is a junior accountant signing. So junior and senior both should sign if the transaction is worth heavy amount. Okay. And just behind the voucher, there will be some bills attached. Okay. These are the bills behind the voucher. So suppose if the purchase bill was there, so you will first tally the voucher and it will be stapled like this. So you will tally the voucher, you will see the bill, okay, you will see purchases showing 10 lakh. On the voucher also, is it written 10 lakh? Okay, fine. So you put a tick mark on the bill 10 lakhs and on the voucher also. Then once you check the bill and the voucher, then you check the voucher and the trial balance. Okay, so once your whole trial balance gets completed, it is traced with all the vouchers. Then from the trial balance, the profit and loss account and balance sheet will be prepared. So you cannot prepare a profit and loss account and balance sheet unless you have checked the voucher. Each and every voucher you have to check. Now, normally, as I told you, auditors find it very difficult to check, you know, so many vouchers. So that is why out of 500 vouchers, he may ask the client, sir, I can check not more than 250 because of test check. Okay, so please give me only 250 vouchers. So you should always apply systematic sampling where you're selecting heavy vouchers, especially the amount should be very much material to you. So every alternative voucher you should, because see, I am telling you 500 because I remember my articleship days where I've checked 5,000 also in one day. You will be also doing the same task. Okay, they'll be telling you to do 5,000 vouchers checking in one day, but then you cannot check. Either you should not go home only, or if you're suppose going home, then you have to tell your client, sir, I want to go home by 6 o'clock, so please give me only 2,500 vouchers. Okay, then depending on how your principal is and how things work, they will be giving you limited vouchers to check. But I'm telling you, in a day, at least anywhere between 500 vouchers to 2,000 to 2,500 vouchers you will have to check. But then you just can't keep on putting ticks. I've seen some articles, they're very smart, they think that they are great people. Okay, they just who's going to come and see, tick tick tick, fada. Okay, done. Okay, this is not auditing. When you're checking vouchers, suppose if your principal comes to know that you are, you know, ignoring such big transactions like 10, just putting ticks and saying, ha, sir, everything is fine, sir. He may extend your articleship for no reason. You'll have to work with him for more months. And the longer time you'll work with him, the longer time he'll trouble you. Okay, so if you want to come out of the trouble fast, be honest with your principal, because they are not going to leave you just like that. And he may not give you your exam leaves. He may cause a lot of trouble to you. Okay, so all list is there, what troubles he can cause you. So just make sure that whenever you're checking something, do it systematically. Is it clear? Just don't be in a hurry to put tick marks so that, oh, tick should be there. Na, who's going to come and see what I've checked? Okay, you have to write queries. You have to write reasons why you put this tick. Suppose if the CFO signature, I'll give you one example. Sometimes, you know, what happens in companies, these CFOs and they sign, but some accountants, they imitate their signatures. So they fiddle with their signatures and they sign as if the CFO has signed. You should go to the CFO and you should first take the signature sample, sample signature of the CFO, keep it with you and see whether the signature is more or less tallying or not. If there is a variation in signature, then in that case, you can ask the CFO of the company, sir, can I come in? He will say, yes, come in. Sir, is it your signature? Then he will say, no, this 10 lakh rupees voucher, I never signed this. Then you can ask the CFO, then who signed, sir? It is your signature showing here. Then the CFO will call the accountant, he'll call the cashier, he'll call all the people to verify. These are how cases where frauds can be found out. You know, 10 lakh rupees is not a small amount. So 10 lakh rupees to earn 10 lakh rupees, he has to work for 2 years. Then only he can earn 10 lakh rupees. So that is a big amount. So CFO, when he's signing like this, and if he says that I have not signed this, somebody has imitated my signature, then you, sir, find out who is the concern. This is how you discover frauds inside company. So I'm just telling you, that is the importance of maintaining vouchers. So actually speaking, voucher acts as a documentary evidence for the auditors. Okay, auditors actually come to know what's happening in the system, in the accounting system. Remember, vouchers are, the concept of voucher holds good only in case of accounting system. Vouchers are also prepared for not only expenses incurred, not only for expenses or incomes incurred. In fact, I remember some companies, private limited, small companies, they don't prepare vouchers for incomes only. They'll say, see, sir, money is coming in, why I should prepare a voucher? If money is going out, you are telling me I'll keep a track of that. But some accountants start arguing that when money is coming in, why should I prepare a voucher for that? It is the matter of internal control to prepare voucher, even if you are getting the money, okay? Even if you're receiving the money, still you put it. At least the auditor will come to know to which head this person has credited the income. Tell me, if I am selling some scrap material, sale of scrap material, it was asked in exam once, sale of scrap material, is it my day-to-day business to sell scrap?
No.
That means if this is a unique kind of transaction taking place, it's a non-recurring transaction. So when suppose scrap or junk material is sold, you cannot credit this sale in the normal sales. Are you understanding what I'm saying? The company may have its regular sales also. So it can't say sale of scrap credited to sales. Okay. You cannot pass this entry. So the entry which accountant will pass will be cash account debit to sale of scrap account. Okay. Sale of scrap account. That means this sale of scrap should actually go into which income? It should go into other incomes, which should be verified. You cannot pass the entry for sale of scrap. You can't say to sales account. This is the wrong entry. This is the correct entry. So sometimes, how will I come to know this? Only when the accountant writes on the voucher that I have credited in the head of sales. I'll say, sir, no, you're wrongly credited. It should not be sales. It should be sale of scrap or other income. So that is the importance of preparing voucher. Through preparation of voucher, you can come to know so many aspects. So when you're checking these transactions, just be very careful that whenever you do some checking of transaction, make sure that vouchers are prepared not only for expenses or income, but they should also be prepared for assets and liabilities. When I'll explain you the topic further, I'll tell you the relevance of preparing vouchers for assets and liabilities also. So the concept that we are studying today is the concept of vouching and verification. The term vouching has been derived from the term voucher. So that you can see this term voucher, as I've written here, voucher is nothing but it's a documentary evidence that needs to be verified by an auditor to ensure that the transaction has been entered in the accounting system. So what's the proof that the transaction has been entered in the system? The only proof which is available is the voucher. So through vouchers, you can precisely come to know whether the accountants are passing timely entries or not, or whether the transaction has been entered in the system or not. That is one thing which I wanted to say. Now the second thing which I want to say here about vouching and verification is that when we are talking about vouching, remember, how is it different from verification? When I'm saying vouching, how is it different from verification? In case of vouching involves nothing but it involves checking of expenses and income. So suppose in my example, suppose this was the exam question asked. Okay, what will you say? Which one amongst this is expense? Any expense you observe here? Now I'll say gratuity paid to employees. If I say paid, na, paid. Understand the concept, the student make mistake in this only. If it is expense, that means it has to be paid by the company. So can I say gratuity paid to an employee is an expense for the company? But suppose instead of that, if they would have asked you in exam, gratuity payable to an employee. It becomes a liability now. Okay, so you read it carefully, because suppose if I give you a point to write for liability, that point will not be same as the point for expenses. Now in world there are so many expenses, they can ask you any expense. How would I know which expense they are going to ask you? And it would be wrong on my side if I tell you to study 200 transactions from your study module. You know, in your study module they have given you 200 transactions. 50 transactions will be for liabilities, 50 expenses, 50 income, 50 assets. But out of that 200, not even one they ask in exam. They ask a weird one only, which you have not studied. So now, if I make you study the 200 transaction and you'll waste time, or maybe if one comes or none comes, then what will you do? Instead of that, you should always study what? Common points. So whenever they ask you a question in exam, your objective is very clear. You easily know that what kind of transaction they are going to ask. So if it is a liability transaction, I will give you points for liabilities, you write them. If there is an expense transaction, I'll give you points for expense, you write them. So you just have to study 3-4 pages and you will be able to comprehend all the 200 transactions. Have you understood? Please clap for this. So, because okay. Don't break, because what happens, I have seen so many people, so many students, what they'll do, they'll open the practice manual, they'll open the module and they'll start studying all the 50-60 transactions, okay? And they're just wasting time, because even if you finish studying, you will not be getting more than 16 marks question. The 100 marks paper is not on vouching and verification, okay? So now, instead of that, I am making your life simple by giving you only so much material to study. Just study that. But then be careful. I expect from a student that he should understand what you mean by paid and what is payable. For payable, you can't write expense points. Okay? You will have to write which points? You will have to write liability points only. So this much effort, if you put in exam and understand the transaction, what they are asking, it will be easier for you. Is it clear or not? So that's the importance of studying vouching and verification. And it's a very easy topic also. Now, if you don't talk and if you allow me to speak, then I can leave you early. So please maintain silence. Let me finish. Can I start now?
Yes, sir.
So as I told you, what's the difference between vouching and verification? Vouching and verification involve, so vouching involves checking of expenses and incomes. Remember, expenses and incomes are part of your profit and loss. So everything to do with profit and loss account is called as what? Vouching. Next point. First, we'll see all the vouching points. Vouching is conducted throughout the year. Why is that so? Because incomes and expenses keep on happening throughout the year. This gives me one more hint. This gives me one more hint that generally speaking, please don't talk. Generally speaking, when I talk about vouching, vouching is generally conducted by the internal auditors of the company. External auditors don't have time to do vouching. And even if they call for doing vouching, even if the external auditors are called for doing vouching, they don't do it themselves. They get it done by article only. I told you, 2,500 vouchers, they will. The principal is going to ask you, you have some work? You will say, no sir, you have to give me work. Then what you do, please do vouching. Okay? Article will never be told to do verification, because verification involves so many accounting policies, knowledge of accounting standards, Schedule 6, company law, this, that, Income Tax Act. There's a lot of issues involved in verification. So instead of that, what you do, you just concentrate on doing vouching. So vouching is generally done by internal auditors, or if internal auditors are not doing vouching, the other category of people who can do vouching is the article clerks. That means throughout your audit, throughout your 3 years of articleship, the 6 months or 8 months, or maybe I have seen some people one and a half year also, they are just told to do vouching only. Different aspects you have to check. I am not saying that you have to do vouching of only one category of transaction. You can check different aspects, but ultimately vouching involves what? Easier work. That you more or less you are concerned with whether the account was correctly debited or not. You know, you should not be mechanical. I sometimes tell to the student, understand the journal entry properly. Don't be mechanical and mug up the entries and go. And I've seen disasters happening. You know, I've seen people mugging up the journal entries without understanding. They mug up the format, how to make the ledger account, how to make the balance sheet. Why you are mugging up something? Because if you mug up, you will not be able to do vouching also. That means a shame on you. Because if you're not able to do vouching also, so you should not mug up journal entries. You should not mug up trial balance. Understand which item will come where, and then accordingly, you will have to just verify the item. Similarly, the examiner may also ask you whether it is liability, whether it is expense. So understand and verify. So vouching is generally done by articles. What is our purpose of doing vouching? More importantly, we have to understand that an auditor has to express true and fair view on the profit and loss account. But why? Why true and fair view? What is the objective of doing vouching? Here is the answer. Important point. Objective of doing vouching. Vouching is done first of all to make sure that the transactions are entered into correct head. That means correct head should be debited or credited. I think I gave you example of sale of junk material. Okay, so instead of crediting sales, you should credit what? Other income. Sale of junk material. One more example. Always remember that the voucher should be sanctioned by the concerned person. Especially heavy transactions which are of more than 5 lakh, 10 lakh. Sir, how will I come to know which one is heavy and which one is not? You should always establish the levels of audit materiality. So based on the levels of audit materiality, you can decide which is heavier one and which is the lighter one. So the BODs and CFOs, you know, sometimes what happens, the BODs and CFOs have not signed on the voucher and the transaction has taken place. So you should go to the BOD and tell him that, sir, why haven't you signed the transaction? Because of, without your signature, how can I say that the transaction is duly sanctioned? Okay, company is incurring 10 lakh, 15 lakh rupees on advertisement expenditures for no reason. Why advertisement? Is it needed to do advertisement? BOD is saying, oh, sorry, sir, I'll sign it now. But then it makes no sense. The transaction already took place. You should have sanctioned the transaction before the transaction is taking place. See, when you are appointed at the senior levels in the company, your responsibilities increase. That time you have to understand that these people are the key people who are responsible, especially for the financial transaction. So you must take their signature, only then the transaction takes place. Internal control policy should be developed that these people should first sign. People should come. Suppose if the cashier is giving cash, the BOD won't even come to know that he has given cash for a heavy transaction. So the rule should be cashier should first go to the BOD, take his approval, only then the cash should be released from the till box. Have you understood or not? So check their signatures whether they are there or not. Transaction should be recorded in the system only when they have been entered. I think I was telling you something about dummy entries. companies in, you know, profit and loss account, you will find some dummy entries, dummy expenses also, just to show that the there are more expenses incurred to fall to lead it in a fall of a net profit, which will ultimately lead to fall of taxes. Okay, so just to pay lower taxes, what companies do, they keep on recording some dummy entries, useless entries. What does this statement means? That the transaction should be recorded only when it occurs in the system. What do you mean by this? Only when it occurs in the system. It clearly means that there should not be any dummy entries. So no dummy entries should be recorded. All these points auditors have to verify, and you will be doing it the day one you join your articleship, vouching. So transactions, only dummy entries if you find in the system and no actual entries, that means how can you say that the profit and loss account is true and fair? As far as possible remove all the dummy entries from the system. Then transactions should be disclosed in the financial statement as per law and as per accounting policies. That means I told you, simple accounting policy, I gave you example of sale of scrap. Law means what? The profit and loss account items should be disclosed. There are correct heads as per law. Follow schedule 6. When I say disclose, disclosure has everything to do with schedule number 6. So when I say disclosure, it means schedule number 6, which is now called as schedule number 3. So transaction should be disclosed in the profit and loss account as per schedule number 3 in case if it's a company. You have to follow schedule number 3 from there. Vouchers. Preparation of voucher is the utmost criteria, because I told you, without the vouchers, how will you certify whether transaction has taken place or not? So vouchers should be dated, it should be numbered, it should be signed by the concerned person. That word sign or sanctioning is always going to be forming part of your voucher. So long as you're preparing vouchers, signatures are must. And not only one, two to three people sign on vouchers. So that means you can imagine the importance of signatures. Without signatures, you should not take the transaction into consideration, or get it signed first and then take it into consideration. You know, all these things what I'm teaching you will give you a working knowledge what you are going to do when you actually start your audit. Put yourself in a practical situation. Suppose if today I tell you that you have cleared your IPCC. How does it feel, you know? IPCC. Now, if you have cleared your IPCC and today is day one of your articleship, first day of your articleship. So you are just going 6 months ahead of, you know, from today. So suppose if you are today in the day one of your articleship, and if these points were not told to you, you would have found it very difficult to actually go and start working. So put yourself in the practical situation, you will understand what I'm trying to say. You know, CA final students also, they also have this topic, but they have it only for 1 or 2 marks. It comes, it does not comes. You all have for 16 marks. When I tell them, sometimes they feel that, sir, this all we already know. But I have to tell them, because many people in CA final also, they may have not done all these points. Nobody would have told them. In IPCC, they would have left this chapter in option, stating, you know, there are 200 points to study, I can't study 200 points. So this knowledge, CA final student understands fast, because they know that these are all the things that they have checked, or maybe they would have not checked it, but then they find it very easy to understand. So what I'm telling you, try to put yourself in the practical situation and understand what I'm trying to say. I am trying to say that when you are doing vouching, be careful, especially when the documentary part is concerned. I think I told you that when I'll be explaining you the distinction, I'll tell you the importance of documents in verification. Suppose if I tell you that you're doing verification, how verification is different from vouching? In fact, I'll tell you one example here. Suppose if I say that this is the asset of the company, it is the asset of the company. Okay, now this is asset physically kept at particular location. This is the physical asset. Now suppose this asset is kept at a particular location, and the company has recorded this asset in its balance sheet also. How will you confirm that this asset belongs to this company only? How will you confirm that? The important point here is that when I'm talking about balance sheet, you have to first see whether the asset is shown at certain value. Now whether if it is shown at this value, whether this value is shown in the invoice or the bill of the asset. Then the bill of the asset should be in the name of the company. Suppose if this company is X Limited, the bill should be made in the name of X Limited only. It can't be in the bill of Y Limited. The bill of Y Limited should be the bill of X Limited. And this is the asset that they have purchased. So you should then go to the physical location and see whether the asset is present or not. If you want, along with you, you can take a copy of fixed asset register also. I think we have discussed in Caro also this point. Okay, so when I'm saying that you're going to take copy of fixed asset, and in Caro also I told you, when you'll be writing answers for vouching and verification, do give references of Caro. In fact, I've made you write that in Caro. So this asset, I check bill, I check fixed asset register, plus I physically check the asset also to see whether it is actually present or not. Present or not, that means I've seen the existence of the asset. That means if the asset is shown in the balance sheet, it is physically present, and how will you confirm that the asset belongs to the company, the company is the owner of the asset? Only when the name of the company is mentioned on the bill. If you want, you can check the copy of agreement with the suppliers also. Suppliers will have a long time agreement with you. They will say that we will keep on supplying assets and inventories to you. So let us enter into a formal agreement for that. So you can check all these points. That means somewhere you will tell me that, sir, in verification, when you are concerned with assets, actually you are not doing vouching. Actually you are verifying things. Because when I say verification, verification means that an auditor is mostly concerned with checking of assets and liabilities. When he is concerned with incomes and expense, then he is doing. So what's the difference between vouching? The thin line difference is vouching and verification. In case of verification, auditors are concerned with assets and liabilities. So suppose if he's concerned with assets and liabilities, do you think that he's not going to check documents? He's just going to see whether asset is present or not. It's not possible only. You have to see documents as well as the physical asset. See, which are the documents I'm checking? I'm checking the bill, I'm checking the agreement, I'm checking the fixed asset register. So this is documentation. So you will say that, sir, in vouching you said you have to check documents, and in verification you are saying you have to check documents plus you have to go and physically see the asset also. So then how will you differentiate between vouching and verification? The differentiation is that if I'm doing vouching, I'm only concerned with documentation. But if I'm saying that I'm doing verification, I'm concerned with documentation also and with the physical assets also. That means the moral of the story is this is a broader concept and this vouching is a narrow concept. Okay, so that means if a person is doing verification, he is actually checking documents also. So simultaneously vouching also keeps on taking place. Whereas when I say he's doing vouching, he's not only doing vouching, he's not doing verification now. So then nothing like verification takes place. So companies exclusively appoint CA to do verification so that the CA can simultaneously check the work of his article, whether his article has done proper vouching or not. You can't expect an article to do verification. So normally what happens, the articles will be restricted to vouching. CA will come, he will check the document so he can cross verify the work of his articles also. In fact, I have written very clearly here that verification is conducted by CA and vouching is conducted by articles clerk. So when you're doing verification, you will also see some documents which are checked by your article assistant. So you can cross verify his work also, and plus your job of doing verification also gets over. So here verification is only conducted at the end of the year. The precise time, the correct time of doing verification is to verify the things only at the end of the year. Reason, what is the reason? Because at the end of the year, you will come to know the state of affairs of the balance sheet as well as the profit and loss account both. In fact, you can see all the assets and liabilities, the depreciation entries, the valuation should be as per accounting standard. All this is much more accurate and precise at the end of the year. There are some companies in which continuous audits keeps on happening. Okay, what do you mean by continuous audit, sir? See, I think I told you that day there's something called as OLRT, online real-time auditing done, that is happening in CATs. So normally when companies have CAT software, what they do, they hire an auditor, maybe he's a stat auditor or an internal auditor. These people, they keep on auditing the data as and when it is taking place, and again at the year end again they do audit. Sir, why is that so? Because in between the transactions have been changed so many times, the entries have been changed so many times, depreciation was wrongly calculated, it got modified several times. So what's the sense of doing continuous audit? In fact, continuous audits are always going to be much more expensive than the year-end audits. Year-end audits are very much, you know, cost-effective for companies, because once all the things have taken place, finally the companies have called their auditors. But in case of continuous audit, they are calling their auditors, they're sitting there and they're doing the work, and again on 31st March, again they're redoing the same work. So it amounts to overlapping or duplication of audit work also. So normally speaking, you will get more better answers if you do verification at the end of the year. But since incomes and expenses keep on happening, vouching is generally done throughout the year. So if you are a statutory auditor of a company and if the principal sends his article to do verification, to do vouching, then the article will be sitting there in the company throughout the year, because as such articles have no work to do except doing vouching. So they will be just sitting there in the company throughout the year and they will be only concerned with vouching the data. And once the vouching gets over, at the year end your principal will come and he will do verification with you. Okay, I'm just trying to tell you the differences between how these things work. As far as verification is concerned, verification is done so that the balance sheet shows a true and fair view. Vouching is done so that the profit and loss. You should write all the statements in exam. The main objective of doing vouching is to ensure that the profit and loss account shows a true and fair view. And the main objective of doing verification is to ensure that the balance sheet shows a true and fair view. But there are objectives which will clarify your point even more. What is the objective of doing verification here? See, I've written it in front of you. You must ensure that whether it is any liability or whether it is any asset, the valuation should be always correct. And generally, when I'm talking about valuation, I'm talking about accounting standards. Who better than a CA can have good knowledge of accounting standards? Nobody. Okay. So generally, the job of doing verification is of a CA, because the CA knows accounting standards more better than anyone else. Okay. So CA will be taking care of the verification aspect, where he will check the valuation. Valuation of accounting standard not only apply to assets, they also apply to liabilities. There are certain accounting standards which are exclusively meant for liabilities, something like AS29. It's a very popular standard for liabilities only. So you have to see whether valuation happens as per accounting standards or not. Then the disclosure should be as per the Schedule 3. I give you the example of companies. Companies will prepare their balance sheets as per Schedule 3. Just like how you prepare profit and loss account as per Schedule 3, similarly you'll have to prepare the balance sheet also. So disclosure should be as per Schedule 3. Existence of the asset. I think my example was very, very clear here, that the asset should be also physically present. So when you will go to the respective location only, you will come to know whether the asset is physically in existence or not. So as an auditor, you have to verify the existence of the asset. How will you confirm the ownership of the asset? If I look at this bill, I will come to know whether I am the owner or someone else is the owner. So basically, the name of the person whose name is written on this bill, his ownership can be confirmed. So if X Limited ka, if the asset belongs to X Limited, how can you write Y Limited's name on this name bill? Okay, that means the asset does not belong to X. Ownership from the bill. So I'm telling you, so for existence, what you have to do, you have to go to the respective situation or location. For ownership, you have to check documents like bills or agreement. So as soon as you get the point, you have to relate it with the concept. How for confirming ownership, I have to always see the documentary part. So when you will check this documentary part, you are doing vouching here. See, in case of this transaction, when I'm checking bills and agreements, okay, if I'm checking bills and agreements, I'm actually doing vouching here. So when I say verification, verification is a broad concept and vouching is narrow in front of it. It will automatically cover vouching also. And the last but not least, you have to also see whether the transaction which has been incurred is treated as a capital or a revenue transaction. Now suppose if I spend money for buying something, okay, if I'm spending money to buy something, the management has to tell you precisely whether that money is spent as a capital expenditure or revenue expenditure. Earlier in accountancy, there was a concept of deferred revenue expenditure also, but now they have removed that concept. So now only what works is capital or revenue. If you're spending, say, 1000 rupees for advertisement, you will say it's a revenue expense. But if I'm saying if you are spending 10 lakh rupees for advertisement, it's a capital expenditure. So capital or revenue expenditure, first distinction should be made, and then you have to see whether it relates to the asset or not. See, if it is a capital expenditure, then the expenditure has to capitalize to the cost of the asset. Okay, AS10 says that. If you are buying a fixed asset and suppose if you are incurring some capital expenditure, then it has to be capitalized to the cost of the asset. But if it's a revenue expenditure, then you cannot add in the cost of the asset, then you have to transfer it to the profit and loss account. So that distinction is very important for us to figure it out, whether it's a capital expenditure or whether it's a revenue expenditure. Have you understood or not? These are the points to be kept in mind when you're doing vouching and verification, but I've only told you the objectives. I have not told you what you have to write in the exam. So can we just write down fast and then we'll leave. You understood all these points? Okay, just giving you 1 minute so that you can read. First point. I will dictate. You have to write this. Points to be verified while checking assets. I will dictate all these points, don't worry. Points to be verified while checking assets. Please give the heading fast. Points to be verified while checking assets. So any asset, if they ask you, this is what you are going to write. First point. Okay. You can see or should I dictate? Yeah. So first point, write down valuation. First point is valuation. Please write down. The auditor has to ensure that assets are correctly valued. Auditor has to ensure that assets are correctly valued. Correctly valued as per applicable financial reporting framework, FRF. As per applicable financial reporting framework. FRF is also called as accounting standards, AS. For example, fixed assets should be valued as per AS 6 and AS 10. Some more examples. Investments as per AS 13. So in exam, if they ask you investments, don't write about fixed assets also. Write only AS 13. Don't show that you know everything. You're not educating the examiner. Goodwill as per AS 14. Goodwill is not valued as per 26. Some people have a misconception here. It's valued as per AS 14. And as per AS 14, you only do the calculation. See, I have written in the bracket. Only calculation of goodwill is done as per AS 14. AS 14 is on accounting for amalgamations. Then other intangible assets like brands, patents, trademarks, copyrights as per AS 26. Other intangible assets should be valued as per AS 26. Then one more example, assets which are acquired on lease assets. There is a freehold and there is a leasehold. So if it's a leasehold asset, it should be valued as per AS 19. That means depreciation, etc. will be charged as per AS 19, accounting for leases. AS 19 is the most difficult standard, AS 19. You don't have it in IPCC, luckily. Full stop. Next point. See, I am dictating, so please concentrate on my dictation. This I have just kept open, but the screen is not that effective to take this. It's written with pencil, that is why. Ownership. Next is ownership. Second point you will verify is ownership. Please write. Auditor must confirm that his client is the actual owner of the assets. Auditor must confirm that his client is the actual owner of the assets for which he should verify fixed asset register, comma, invoices of the suppliers to ensure that the name of the company means the client for whom you are auditing, name of the company is mentioned on the invoice. Full stop. He should also verify agreements of the suppliers. He should also verify agreements of the suppliers. Also verify agreements of the suppliers. Full stop. Next point, existence of the asset. Third point is existence of the asset. Write down. It is essential for an auditor. It is essential for an auditor to verify all tangible assets. Please underline tangible assets. Existence can't be done for intangibles. To verify all the tangible assets, including cash, to ensure that they are genuinely stated in the balance sheet. To ensure that they are genuinely stated in the balance sheet. Full stop. For this, auditor should visit the respective location. For this, auditor should visit the respective location where the asset is kept. I told you he has to visit the respective location. Underline this word location. Visit the respective location. Full stop. This will reduce the possibility of window dressing. Why I'm saying window dressing? Because the assets are not present, then also they write in the balance sheet. So if the asset is present, only then you should write. So you just write there in the bracket. It means that window dressing, into bracket write down, it means that only if the asset is present, additional point, it means that only if the asset is present at the location, only if the asset is present at the location, it will be recorded in financial statements. It will be recorded in financial statements. Full stop. Next point. Retirement of assets. Acha, tell me, before you're writing retirement, is this point intangible assets applicable to intangibles? No. How can you verify existence for intangible assets? I've already told you, valuation paper. So you just write there, not in case of intangibles. So in exam, if they ask you patents, you can't write I'll verify existence of patents. You should verify valuation paper, how patents are valued. So you write there, not in case of intangible assets. Means this point does not apply to intangible assets. Okay, next point you can say retirement of assets. Next is retirement of assets. Now, what do you mean by retirement, sir? I've written the meaning. Retirement means if you sell the asset, dispose of the asset, or if you scrap out the asset, how do you verify that thing? Right? Retirement means sale. Retirement means sale, disposal, or scrapping of assets, sale, disposal, or scrapping of assets. Full stop. Please underline, this is the meaning of the term retirement. Whenever an asset is retired, continue. Whenever an asset is retired, the asset account must be closed. The asset account must be closed. And under the provisions of Companies Act, under the provisions of Companies Act, depreciation should be charged proportionately. Under the provisions of Companies Act, depreciation should be charged proportionately. Which needs to be verified by an auditor. Which needs to be verified by an auditor. Please understand what I'm saying. If you use asset for only 3 days, in company law you only charge depreciation for 3 days. 3 divided by 365. That does not happen in case of income tax. In case of income tax, you follow block of asset method. So under the block of asset method, if I use an asset for 3 days also, I have to charge half year depreciation. Okay, in income tax, which method you, so I have given an example to relate Companies Act with income tax. Depreciation under income tax and Companies Act are not going to be the same. That is why we file two balance sheets. We prepare two balance sheets. One as per income tax and one as per Companies Act. Under Companies Act, we charge depreciation on what basis? Proportionate basis. Please underline that term, proportionate. So if I bought an asset on 27th of March and if I used it and I sold it on 31st of March, I have to charge depreciation for from 27th to 31st of March only for the number of days I use the asset. Under company law I am saying, but under income tax law, if I am charging an asset for, say, if I am using it for 5 days also, I will be charging half year depreciation on it. So if the rate of depreciation is 10%, 5% depreciation should be charged. But if I am saying I am using the asset for more than 180 days, because the criteria to consider here is 180 days and 360 days. If you are using asset for 180 days or more, then the depreciation should be charged for a half year. And if you are using it for more than 180 days, then it is charged for full year. So less than 180 days, equal to 180 days, charge it for half year. This, where is it written, sir? It's written in section number 32 of the Income Tax Act. Okay. Very important for IPCC also. Section 32 of the Income Tax Act says that you have to charge depreciation using the block of asset method. It means what? If you are going to use an asset for 180 days only, that means you have to charge half year depreciation. You use an asset for 190 days, sir. Should I charge it for 190 days? No. You have to charge it for 360 days. Whole year you have to charge depreciation. So that is why there is a difference between depreciation. So my profits as per income tax will be little lesser as compared to the profits as per the Companies Act. Because in company law, I am charging depreciation on a proportionate basis. Have you understood or not? So we will give this example to the examiner. We will explain him that this is what auditor has to see. Write down. Example, if an asset is purchased and then sold, then as per the Income Tax Act, Income Tax Act which section? Section number 32. As per the Income Tax Act, section number 32. Depreciation is charged using the block of asset method. Please underline this. Using the block of asset method for 180 days and 360 days respectively. 180 days and 360 days respectively. Full stop. Now you listen to me. Suppose if you sell the asset, which account will be credited? If you sell the asset, forget the money received. You tell me which account will be credited. You know what accountants do? Instead of crediting the asset account, they will credit the sales account. as if they are selling goods. Are you understanding? I think I showed you the same example for scrap material also. So you have to rectify those entries. You have to tell the accountant that, sir, purchase and sale of asset is not the course of regular business activity. You can't credit the sales account. You have to credit which asset account. Have you understood or not? Next point. In this only, retirement only, next point. Write down. Also, when asset is sold, sales account cannot be credited. Cannot be credited as selling of an asset which will be used for economic benefits. Economic benefits is not a regular business activity of the client. Therefore, following entry should be passed. So what's the correct entry? Cash or bank account debit to asset account. If there is a profit and loss, accordingly you can debit or credit. Debit the loss, credit the profit. Full stop. So these are all the points you have to remember for assets, but there are still few more. Next is documentary evidence. Full 4 marks, you should keep it in your hand. You write these points, take 4 marks. For one answer, like this, there are 4 answers. Write on documentary evidence. While verifying assets, auditor should check the following documents. Can I say this is a part of vouching? Documentation is part of vouching. Auditor should check following documents. Number one, the invoice for the purchase of asset. The invoice is a very important document. It can confirm the ownership. The invoice for purchase of asset. Number second, the tax challan for taking input credit. That means if you pay some VAT or excise duty on the asset purchase, you can take the set off. You know indirect taxation?
Yes,
excellent people. Tax challan for taking input credit. Then the next one, fixed asset register. Very important document. Even CARO says to maintain fixed asset register. Next document is fixed asset register. Then you should also verify bank statements. Next one, bank statements. Verify bank statements. I think I've already explained to the importance of minutes book. Okay, board of directors can only take the decision for sale and purchase. So you can verify minutes book also. So minutes book to verify. Minutes book to verify the decision in connection with sale and purchase of assets. If you buy an asset, of course, you'll enter into a formal agreement with the supplier also. So you can say agreements with suppliers or lessors. Lessor's agreement if you have taken asset on lease. And last point for asset is disclosure requirements. I told you disclosure means we are talking about schedule 3. We are talking about schedule 3, disclosure requirements. So see the language how it is written, exactly same we'll write. While verifying assets, write down. While verifying assets, an auditor has to ensure, while verifying assets, an auditor has to ensure that if law lays down, that if law, here law means company law, law lays down any specific disclosure requirements, law lays down any specific disclosure requirements, then the same are followed, then the same are followed by the company, same are followed by the company. For example, assets should be only disclosed. For example, assets should be only disclosed as per the format prescribed by Schedule 3. Assets should be only disclosed as per the format prescribed by Schedule number 3. Full stop. I will dictate. Shh, please give the heading. I'm not explaining, just don't apply your brains, just write. Tomorrow I'll explain. I will dictate, so please give the heading. Points to be verified while checking liabilities. Points to be verified while checking liabilities. First point. Auditor should examine, first point, auditor should examine the records, auditor should examine the records to ascertain the nature of liability, auditor should examine the records to ascertain the nature of liability as it can be a short-term liability, as it can be a short-term liability or a long-term liability or a long-term liability or a contingent liability or a contingent liability. Contingent liability. And on the basis of these records, the liabilities should be disclosed in the balance sheet. The liabilities should be disclosed in the balance sheet. So in this point, you have to underline two things. Number one, records. Auditor should always see records to confirm whether it's a short term or long term. The first word is records. And the second word you should underline is disclosed. Disclosure. So disclosed. Full stop. Second point. Auditor must adopt direct confirmations Auditor must adopt direct confirmation process. Direct confirmation process, which will enable to advise the management, which will enable to advise the management whether to make a provision or to disclose it as a contingent liability. Full stop. As per standards on auditing 505, an auditor can obtain external confirmation from the company's lawyers by inquiring the status of the suit which is pending. Full stop. This will enable the management to either create a provision or to disclose it as a contingent liability.